Who was Duke Ellington? That's a good question. Maybe the question should be, who is Duke Ellington? Well, there's Duke Ellington. He's looking at us, right at us, from a photo taken just about 60 years ago, at a recording session, at a rehearsal, somewhere where his band was playing. And he's looking right at us. Of course, we'll never know what it was that Edward Kennedy Ellington had in his mind when the photographer snapped this wonderful portrait. But it gives us the opportunity, just by looking at that expression on his face, to ponder the following question. Was Ellington an invisible man? Was Ellington misunderstood for most of his life? I think the answer is yes. Now, it's hard to imagine that someone who was an internationally famous entertainer, bandleader, performer, composer, just presence for the better part of half a century, could in any sense be invisible. Or in any sense, be misunderstood. But read the press, listen to the interviews, read the things written about him, and you'll find out that he was most times thought to be a very talented big band leader, and to some folks, the great jazz composer. But to the great majority of people during his lifetime, certainly a jazz composer could not be compared to composers of quote-unquote serious music. Now that is a ridiculous concept, hearing it in today's world. But in the world that he lived in, jazz was perpetually, if not misunderstood, if not condescended to, given short shrift in terms of being an enduring element of American culture. And all those things, I think, help us understand Ellington's music all the more, because for the better part of 50 years, he wrote music every day of his life. for all of his reputation as a bon vivant and all the things that went with being a famous celebrity like he was, the people who knew him knew that every night, no matter where he was, on the road, in that hotel room, or on that train, he sat down to compose. Now, he didn't just compose music. He composed a wonderful book. It's called Music is My Mistress. And the book, like his music, exists on many different levels of irony and sophistication and beauty all at once. Where does Ellington's genius really reside? Well, of course it resides in his music. Music that he composed for fascinating combinations of instruments, not just his big band, his jazz orchestra, which he managed to evoke a range of sounds that equaled a symphony orchestra, or maybe even surpassed a symphony orchestra at times in its originality. He wrote for solo piano. He wrote for the violin. He wrote for just a few horns. He wrote for vocalists. He wrote music that was then expanded for symphony orchestras. He wrote many, many different things. And every single note of every composition that he ever wrote had that Ellington DNA in it. Well, I think you'll agree it's time to get to the music. And we're going to begin with two selections recorded 38 years apart. The first one is one of the very first Ellington recordings, if not the first. It's called Choo Choo. It's recorded in 1924 with a band of his Washington buddies, for the most part, called the Washingtonians. And then we'll jump to 1962 and a recording session that he did with John Coltrane, playing In a Sentimental Mood, one of Ellington's great tunes. And it's fun to think about, if Ellington could have heard that 1962 record back in 1924, what he might have thought. Would he have thought, what the heck is that? I've never heard music like that, chords like that, a saxophone sound like that, just something from the bizarre, unimaginable future? Or was it already in his mind at that time that he was going to keep evolving for the rest of his life? And if this is what it sounded like when it evolved, well, so be it. It's almost a ridiculously hypothetical question that I just asked, but it's worth pondering if you like to ponder things. Regardless, let's get to the music, and after we hear these two wonderful selections, we'll dig deep into Ellington's background. Thank you. What an amazing thing to hear Ellington over the course of 38 years with his early band, the Washingtonians, playing that kind of doo-wackadoo jazz of the early 1920s. And then 38 years later, he's at the piano playing with John Coltrane and Elvin Jones, and they're playing what was already an old Ellington tune in a sentimental mood in such a contemporary fashion. And it really just underlines Ellington's incredible status as a performer, as an artist who just evolved, who could take whatever happened in his musical purview, not just jazz, but whatever it was that happened that he liked, he could take it and digest it, and it came out as something Ellingtonian. Absolutely amazing that he did this all throughout his career, and also that he managed to remain a popular figure in popular culture. I mean, it's an amazing accomplishment, surpassed by none and equaled by very, very few. He's born in Washington, D.C., 1899. Of course, you saw the birth dates on the original panel that we presented. He died in New York City in 1974. He was born Edward Kennedy Ellington. He acquired the nickname Duke early on. The name Kennedy comes from his mother. That was his mother's maiden name. Ellington's father, James, worked as a butler for a local doctor in Washington, D.C. He also had various side gigs in those years, working not only as a butler, but in catering and all kinds of events. It's even been said that occasionally he gigged at the White House. That's never been nailed down. But nonetheless, it raises an amazing fact in Ellington's career. Ellington had his 70th birthday party thrown in the grand manner by the President of the United States, President Richard Nixon, at the White House in 1969. And you imagine Ellington and his dad going by the White House in those years, the 19-teens. We could even have pondered the fact that something like that could have even have been possible at that time. It's worth noting, since this is a program of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, that our founder, Leonard Garment, who was working in the Nixon White House at that time, kind of as a arts czar, was behind that birthday party. It's an amazing thing. But equally, well, not amazing, but sadly true, is that when Ellington turned 13 years old, or slightly before he turned 13, but anyway, in 1912, America elected a virulently racist president who managed to turn back many of the gains that had slowly been happening in the era, in the area of civil rights. His name was Woodrow Wilson, and he disallowed African Americans from being civil servants and just brought in a whole regime that that harkened back to the days of Reconstruction, or post-Reconstruction, I should say. It was a horrible time. And one can only imagine the effect that this had on the teenaged Ellington as he pondered his father's future, his own future in this country. Ellington, as a composer, did something miraculous, and that was he merged composition and improvisation in an amazing fashion, some say in a new way. It's long been said that the best composed music sounds improvised and the best improvised music sounds composed. And what we can take from that is that when you hear a great artist, let's just talk about piano for the moment, play something written hundreds of years ago for the piano, when they play it, if they're really getting to it, it can sound as though they're creating it right in front of you. It sounds improvised, although it was all written a long time ago. And on the other side, music that is improvised sometimes has the great characteristics of sounding like something that was composed. It has a beginning, it has a middle, it has an end, it has almost a predictable quality to it at times, the same things that you think about when you hear composed music. And Ellington, through his blending of the great improvisations of not only that he did, but of the people in his band, and how he codified it all by writing things down. And in those written down things, doing a musical equivalent of amendments to the Constitution, which is leaving windows to be opened in those compositions in the same way that amendments do with the Constitution. Leaving windows open for a Ben Webster, for a Cootie Williams, for a Jimmy Blanton, for a Johnny Hodges, to open the window of the composition up and make something absolutely new happen, so that every performance of an Ellington piece became pure jazz, pure improvisation, and also pure composition. Of course, there are exceptions to that rule, but that's a fair thing to say, and it just kind of shines a light on one of the great accomplishments of Ellington. As we mentioned before, he remained a popular artist throughout his 50-year career. And in the 1950s, going into the 60s, when big band music that Ellington loved became hard to sell commercially, he underwrote the expenses of keeping this all-star band on the road with the royalties from his compositions. He could have just taken that money and retired and lived like a king. He did live like a king, but his idea of living like a king, or maybe king is a funny word, his idea of living, and he talks about this in interview segments that we'll see as part of this series, was being on the road with his own private orchestra. He could write the music one night, wake up the next morning, put the music down, and he could hear it. And that was his definition of a good life. And finally, before we get back to the music, actually, we're going to get to Ellington talking in just a moment. What he became didn't exist when he was born, when he decided to dedicate his life to music. He created his own reality. There were no African-American composers touring the world with their own private orchestra, writing music the likes of which had never been heard before, that attained great popularity, and also music that was for listening. And sometimes listening and popularity are are not mutually exclusive. All of Ellington's music, from the shortest piece to the longest, from the most quote-unquote simple to the most quote-unquote complicated, all of it is worthy of study and listening to. And the fact that he put all of this together when no one had even imagined such a career is just one of the amazing vital facts about Duke Ellington. Well, that's enough talk from me. Let's go to Ellington himself. And here he is in Scandinavia in the early 1960s. And all I can tell you is every word, every gesture, every wink of the eye, just everything about it is worth listening to and watching again and again. You're going to find out a lot about who Duke Ellington was from this incredible interview. It's one of the few ones where he kind of lowered the mask a bit and let us see just a little bit of the real Ellington.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Duke Ellington. I have a band of musicians who are en route to Sweden at the moment, and all the kids in the band want you to know that we do love you madly. And now it's my pleasure to introduce my very, very good friend of the Swedish broadcasting system, Mr. Sven Lindahl.
And first of all, Mr. Ellington, you must know how very, very much we enjoy seeing you here again. Well, you've been here before, Duke Ellington, with this band, coming by boat, coming by train, but this time you go by air.
Yes, this time we hope to fly in. That is, unless I can find a more convenient railroad. Mm.
So or you're car. Not, you're not frightened to go by air?
Oh, no, not at all. Flying just isn't one of my top kicks.
Is there anything that frightens you?
Anything? Hmm? Yes. When I walk on stage, I always enjoy a little stage fright. And, of course, then I must muster up a certain amount of courage and get the ranks closed in and try and have the kids blow the fright away, you know. And, of course, we have an organization of musical instrumentalists who are considered jazz giants internationally. And they make a major contribution toward blowing away this stage fright. I know you know a lot of the kids in the band. You've met most of them. I think this is the only band of its kind in the world where you have the equivalent to possibly, what might call it, a jazz festival that stays organized most of the time. Well, 52 weeks a year, anyway. Well, we would do 53 weeks, but they aren't 53 weeks. They include, well, there's Johnny Hodges, Cat Anderson, Ray Nance, Harry Carney, Paul Gonzalez, Jimmy Hamilton, Russell Prokop, Lawrence Brown, Sam Woodyard. Who'd I leave out? Oh, Ernie Shepard. Oh, all giants, you know. And really, this is more specialists than you would find normally in about eight bands. But I get my kicks listening, so I give them all the money and I just take the kicks.
People studying your music, studying your band, your style, say that the style of Duke Ellington, the wonderful rhythm, has been rather the same all through these 30 years. What about the future?
The future? Oh, I think the future is going to be all of this wonderful music that has been inspired by the distant, rumors out of Africa, transplanted to America and the Caribbean, where they've taken several routes around America, some to South America, some across Mississippi River and up there, and others that come right up the East Coast, which is a very sophisticated music, but not as sophisticated as the rhythm of Africa. This has been supplemented by music out of the conservatories of music. We have musicians who are coming out with their degrees today. For instance, I would say that 1/4 of them go into the symphony, 1/4 go into teaching, 1/4 I would say go into the television and radio stations, and the other 1/4 would go into what is known as jazz music. And in spite of the fact that they all come out of the same conservatories, I cannot see how they can be separated. So I consider what all these 4 categories put together can be called the music of the future, when it will be boiled down and left without a category, even the category of jazz, because I think it's going to be accepted generally and soon that music is music, and there is not going to be any symphonic music, there's going to be no jazz music, it's just going to be music. And if it sounds good, it's going to be good music, and if it doesn't, it won't be music.
For the Swedish TV, you have specially written ballad music. And people in Stockholm, they say that it's a very, very modern style. In that music, are we going to meet another Duke Ellington? Another style?
Another Duke Ellington? No, this was suggested by Mr. Arnbaum when he was in New York. And he gave me a time limit to present a group of dancers, and he told me how he wanted them to make their entrances and so forth. And this music is more or less tailored to a very, very short conversation we had one night in reviewing the program for this particular TV special.
Here we have Ellington the painter. Ellington was a talented draftsman and a talented painter, in the thought of a career in the fine arts for a moment, actually, as a teenager. It's said that he received a scholarship to the Pratt Institute, or at least was offered one. Of course, he didn't go down that road. And when we hear about Ellington the painter, it's usually in the way that he painted with music. He painted harmony and color and timbre and orchestration. You know, Ellington had just 10 horns in his band throughout the 1930s. And with those 10 horns, plus piano and bass and guitar and drums, he was able to come up with combinations of instruments and sounds and textures that other composers who had a symphonic orchestra at their disposal couldn't have imagined. Absolute miraculous things that he accomplished as a composer and orchestrator throughout his whole career. And there was a wonderful statement made that went like this. I'll paraphrase it. I think it was Andre Previn who said it, but it went like this. And again, this is a paraphrase. A famous bandleader who's famous for modern, quote-unquote, modern progressive music. He can stand in front of his band, have them play some crazy far-out chord, and if I were to hear it on a record, I could sit down and write down what every note played. It may have been far out and complicated, but it was very easy to figure out. On the other hand, Ellington can stand in front of his band, hold up a finger, have 3 people stand up and play a chord, and I'll be damned if I can figure out what it is. Now, that's a paraphrase of that famous statement. But what it comes down to is that Ellington did one of the hardest things ever to do, which is to write for a few instruments and make combinations of making a trumpet or a trombone or a clarinet do things that they ordinarily didn't do, and then put them in very unusual juxtapositions. And he created sounds that you just, that were totally unique and to many ears unfathomable. Well, they were as unfathomable as they were beautiful. This is a very important part of the world that Ellington arrived out of, or came out of, I should say. And it has to do with Antonin Dvorak and the story that I'm going to try and tell you in a very short amount of time. Was for the first time told and for the best time told in a wonderful book by the late Maurice Perez. It's called From Dvorak to Ellington. And in great detail, he gets into this story that I'm going to summarize for you. But it's really an essential read about a facet of American music that is not taught and rarely talked about. The woman in the center here, her name was Jeanette Thurber. She was very much involved in musical education. And in the early 1890s, she decided that it was time to bring over a great European composer to teach American composers how to write quote-unquote serious music, or what we now think of as classical music. And eventually the great Czech composer from Bohemia, actually, Antonín Dvořák, came over, arriving in 1893, and Miss Thurber put together a group of students that miraculously for the time was not just white men. There were women there and there were African-American folks too. For the time, a very diverse audience. And Dvorak arrived. You can see him and his family on the left. He's the one on the right wearing, I believe that's called a bowler. And he was asked upon arrival, how are you going to teach American composers how to write? You know, because America had and still has, in some sense, a cultural feeling of inferiority when it comes to the European classics. And again, to paraphrase, we're doing a lot of paraphrasing here, Dvorak said, well, give me a moment, you know, to check out the music over here, and I'll get back to you and let you know how I'm going to teach these American composers. And when he was asked, after listening to some of the music that was shared with him, he said in so many words, you know, I can teach American composers how to write the way that we write. In Europe, you know, we have an aristocratic system, and we write music that comes out of that society. You already have your own society here and your own great music, the seeds of which, you know, you can grow into whatever you want them to grow into. And what he was referring to was what at the time was known as Negro spirituals, the spirituals that came out of the African-American churches. He famously wrote his Going Home theme. We'll hear that in just a moment as a tribute to those sounds. On the right, we see a photograph of Will Marion Cook. Will Marion Cook was a wonderful violinist, also a composer, teacher, pedagogue. And the story that is often told about him is that he received a review and was called America's Greatest Negro Violinist. He was so upset about it, he took a violin up to the critic who had written this piece and supposedly smashed the violin on the desk and said, I am not America's greatest Negro violinist. I am America's greatest violinist. This is what he was up against. And we'll just remark here parenthetically that in 2020, so many American orchestras, symphonic orchestras, opera orchestras remained, I should say, remained tremendously segregated. Anyway. Will Marion Cook became a composer and arranger. He wrote popular music. He wrote music for concert presentation. And importantly to Ellington, he became Ellington's mentor. And in later years, where Ellington said, I never went to the conservatory, you know, everything he needed to know about music, he could ask Will Marion Cook, and Ellington said, you know, he would hire a horse-driven cab, and he and Will Marion Cook would ride around Central Park. And he would just ask Cook exactly what he needed to know and how to solve musical problems. Let's, for a moment, hear some of the music that Dvorak was referring to when Harry T. Burley, who was his amanuensis, turned him on to some of the wonderful choral and African-American spirituals of the time. And we'll hear a recording that's well over 100 years old, of the Fisk Jubilee Singers. And again, you know, you hear remnants of all of this in Ellington.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for the Academy.
Sometimes up and I'm and what did I see?
Coming for the Academy
when the day is
That magical music, Mahalia Jackson and Duke Ellington together, represents, believe it or not, just one part of Ellington's musical universe. And none of that universe really would have happened the way it did without his commercial success. The fact that he wrote Mood Indigo and It Don't Mean a Thing If It Ain't Got That Swing and Sophisticated Lady and all those wonderful songs, starting in the 1930s especially, that made him such a beloved popular figure, that the more artistic things he wanted to do, the ones that were not going to be big selling albums or 78 RPM records, that he was able to do those things because of his commercial success and how he always managed to take the high road artistically, musically. You know, first impressions are lasting. And the images that we see here are really how Ellington arrived to the world at large. He had fits and starts in the 20s. His real fame began, we'll get into this in subsequent parts of this series, at the Cotton Club in New York and all that stuff. But by the 1930s, when the hit tunes started happening and the European tours and the appearing in Hollywood films and all that, this was the image that people saw. Just look at the urbane, sophisticated, handsome genius that Ellington was. And as we conclude this introductory part of just trying to set some context for Ellington's great career and achievements, let's see him in a Hollywood film of the early 1940s with his great band playing his theme song, which was written by his writing companion, Billy Strayhorn, Take the A-Train. This is the Ellington of the movies, of the theater, that entranced audiences that were getting a musical education whether they wanted one or not.
¶¶ should take,
if you should take
a train,
Dario,
you get to where you're going in a hurry.
Hurry,
hurry, hurry, hurry. Now it's coming. Can't you hear the rails will hum? Leota, if you should miss the A train, you'll miss the quickest way to get to Harlem.
Before we leave this first part, this introductory part of our series, Who Is, Who Was Duke Ellington, we turn to the blues. Because if there's one touchstone throughout all of Ellington's music, either as a performer, as a composer, with his band, it was that he and the band were never more than a stone's throw away from the blues. Now, sometimes it wasn't a blues tune, most times it wasn't. But the concept of what the blues represents and the whole ethos of the blues really suffused everything that Ellington ever did. And it's a fascinating project sometimes to go back and listen to the wide variety of music that he wrote, some of which certainly didn't sound like the blues on the surface, and realize that it was always there. Here we see just the first page of one of his blues masterpieces. It was called Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue, and this is actually Ellington's handwriting. And at some point later on in the series, we'll share this page with you and kind of break it down a little bit and kind of show you the various facets of his genius that are reflected in his hand holding a pencil, writing on a piece of musical manuscript. You don't have to know one note from another note to be able to understand this, trust me. And we'll get to that later, but it just brings up the point of Ellington and the blues. Now, this next closing segment for this presentation is Ellington in the mid-1960s with his band, featuring some musicians who had been with him off and on for the better part of 40 years. And they're playing some of the earliest tunes of Ellington's career from the mid-1920s, written with his first writing companion, even before Billy Strayhorn, Bubber Miley, a great trumpet player who will talk about later, who really helped Ellington understand the blues. And the first great Ellington pieces were mostly co-written with Bubber Miley. Now, the amazing thing about this is that this concert recording is from, you know, almost 40 years after he originally played these pieces. And while on the one hand, they capture the flavor kind of some of the 1920s, I mean, they are contemporary. And not only contemporary for the 1960s when this clip comes from, but they're contemporary today. They really transcend all the styles and all the labels that surround jazz music. It is just, well, Ellington actually tried to get rid of the word jazz. He just wanted to call it music. He used to say there's good music and bad music. And we'll see another quote from him where he talks about that. But it's a great way to go out of this segment with Ellington going back to the past and at the same time very much in the present. And these recordings are 55 years old or so. They're certainly great for the future, too.
expression they feel free about vintage oldies, the black and tan fantasy, Creole love call, and the mooch.
Thank you.
is the Picasso man.
Thank you so much for joining us for this presentation of the National Jazz Museum in Harlem's Jazz for Curious Listeners series. Who was Duke Ellington? Or as we said before, maybe better, who is Duke Ellington? This was part one. My name is Lauren Schoenberg. I'm the senior scholar at the museum, and on behalf of the staff and the board and everyone involved with the museum, we hope you will come visit us when that becomes possible. And in the meantime, enjoy all of the various programming that we do. It's not all of a historical nature. And you can find out about all of it on our Facebook page, on our website, www.jmih.org. Again, thank you, and let's go out with some great Ellington.
It's been the music of Duke Ellington and his orchestra. The Duke and his boys will be back next week to bring you another United States Savings Bond program presented by the American Broadcasting Company with the cooperation of the American Federation of Musicians, James C. Petrillo, President. Hank Weaver speaking. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.